And God bless us all. So now I'd like to welcome our moderator, Professor Marlinda Adham. She doesn't need much introduction. She used to be the president of ASHNO and, of course, a very well-known singer. So Marlinda, take over. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Prof. Alfredo, for the nice introductions of me. I'm happy to be the moderator for the 7 episodes of Asians Head and Neck webinar and the first time in 2021. And as we know that even nasopharyngeal carcinoma represent a rare disease in the Western countries, such in Europe and United States, but in some regions, such as in the Southeast Asia and in Southern Asia, NPC is still a problem with to us in the endemic cancers with a high mortality rate. So the discussions and research are always challenging according the early diagnostic assessment about what the best imaging can be used, the treatment and the follow-up management, and also how to treat the residual and the recurrent disease. That's the reason we bring these topics to all of you. I would like to remind you that this webinar also will be recorded. And for the participants, there will be the quiz and a poll. And after all the all the presenters and all the panelists will present, will give a presentations. And all the participants can also use chat room to write a questions. Today we have 5 well-known speakers and panelists in the field of NPC from the different countries. For the first speakers, I would like to introduce. The first one is Professor Chui Ming Lim. He will talk about the epidemiology and diagnosis of NPC. Professor Ming Lim is a head and neck surgeon at Department of Otolaryngology Head and Neck Surgery, Singapore General Hospital, and associate professor with the Duke NUH Medical School. He heads the Departments of Clinical Translational Research at HGH and serves as an adjunct clinician scientist at Institute of Bioengineering and Nanotechnology. Thank you. And then please, Professor Ming Lim.
Thank you, Melinda, for the kind introduction. Can I have a share screen right now? Perfect. All right, so I've been a pleasure to meet everyone on this platform. I'd like to thank the committee for this wonderful organization. And it's very thankful to see many of our good friends in this COVID times. I've been tasked to speak about epidemiology and the diagnosis of nasopharyngeal cancers. I think Melinda has introduced where I come from. I have no specific disclosure on this series of slides that I'm going to present. I'd like to overview the epidemiology of this particular cancer, NPC. I think most of us are very familiar with this cancer. Secondly, I would like to touch about the use of plasma EBV in the diagnosis and management of this cancer, specifically in terms of screening for this cancer, surveillance, and finally, in terms of prognostication. And I will also give some directions of what researchers are doing, at least in this field of liquid biopsies in nasopharyngeal cancers. So to begin the ball rolling, this is taken out from the WHO statistics taken in 2018, where they look at the age standardized incident rate of nasopharyngeal cancers across the world. As you can rightly see, the areas that are highlighted dark blues are where this cancer is particularly endemic. What is known about this cancer, it has a predominant male population, about 3:1. And you can see among the high incidence NPC countries, they are predominantly EBV positive cancers. And what is noteworthy is that patients who have migrated at least from these endemic countries to the non-endemic countries still have fairly high incidence even after they have settled down in the countries that they have migrated to, suggesting there may be some genetic or cultural dietary prevalence. The next slide, you can see that based on figures, at least this cancer is very prevalent only in the southern part of China, such as Guangzhou and Zhongshan. And when you look at the breakdown in Penang, for instance, it has a fairly high predominance of Chinese population being afflicted with these cancers. And when you look in terms of this epidemiology data from the endemic and non-endemic NPC, you can see that at the age of about 40 is where the incidence will sharply peak and then fairly plateau after the age of 40. And even in endemic countries such as in North Africa, this similar trend is also observed. So I'd like to highlight Asia as well as ASEAN countries where you can see that predominantly we are living in areas where this cancer is highly endemic. So the clinical context of this cancer is that majority of our patients present with a cervical lymph node in the neck. Typically, when the tumor is localized over the eustachian cushion, patient may present with otitis media with effusion. Other symptoms will include bloodstained nasal discharge and other rarer symptoms such as cranial nerve palsy because of intracranial involvement. The risk factors of this cancer can be divided into modifiable and non-modifiable. Among the potentially modifiable risk factors will include cigarette smoking and certain dietary preference that is prevalent in certain cultural, such as the consumption of salted vegetables, salted fish, and preserved food because they contain fairly high compounds of nitrosamine, which is a known carcinogen. Among the modifiable risk factors will include the EBV virus. You can see that this virus is fairly ubiquitous. I think invariably everyone will be exposed to this virus. But how this virus goes into the cells and then subsequently develop into NPC is still an area of intense research. There are some studies suggesting there's some genetic predisposition relating to the HLA genes that may predispose a particular race to having NPC. The other possibility will include innate susceptibility against this virus. This will relate to how the host immune system interacts with this virus and then allow this virus to persist in the patients. This is a study taken about 3 years ago in National Cancer Center, where they look at the association of lifestyle and diet with the risk of NPC. Certainly, smoking risk and consumption of diet came out very prominently in this analysis. So this is a cohort studies where they compare controls versus index NPC patients. And certainly you see that patients who are smokers have nearly 4.5 odds ratio of developing NPCs. And even patients who have not stopped smoking, I think the risk is reduced, but it's still approximately 2.4 odds ratio. And in terms of dietary consumption, certainly salted fish, salted meat, and salted vegetable came prominently among the interviewers. And the risk varies from about 2.3 to up to 3.7, depending whether this is taken weekly or monthly. When we look in terms of how this virus is transmitted, at least into the nasopharyngeal epithelial cells, this is our recent review on this subject. And you can see that when this virus is being transmitted in the airborne droplets, it is then inhaled by the host. It goes to the epithelial cells in the nasopharynx or even in the oral cavity, oral pharynx, and then these cells will then lyse and resulting in migration of these virions into the circulation. It will then be then inoculated in the B cells primarily, where they could immortalize these B cells. And among the Wardeus ring in the oral pharynx, the nasopharynx, and the lingual tonsils, that's where the EBV may go into the latent phase. However, these B cells that are circulating eventually will develop into plasma cells, and these plasma cells may then go into a lytic phase where the virions are then released, and then the whole cycle repeats itself. So this is how the latent and the lytic reactivation phase of this virus happens continually in the host upon transmission of this virus. So we have been interested to look at the role of innate immunity, particularly natural killer cells, in terms of how these cells identify EBV infection and subsequently EBV-associated NPCs. So this is currently under revision, but we can look at the two cycle, the lytic and the latent phase. We want to focus primarily in the latent phase because it's only in the latent phase where this virus develop into a carcinogenic pathway for NPC development. And these are some of the mechanisms where the viruses would then escape the immune surveillance system, such as the overexpression of some PD-1 molecules and also the latent proteins such as LNP1 and LNPB2. So the diagnosis is clinched on standard immunohistopathologies. You look at the classical H&E stains, you can see very big new cells with prominent nuclei. And what is characteristics for this cancer is that because they are EBV positive, when you do a stain for EBA, which stands for EBV encoded RNA, you can see a remarkable stains of this this tumor cells with the EBV positive stains. And you look at the diagnosis, typically by the WHO classification, it will be the non-keratinizing undifferentiated variant that is classically EBV positive. So what is interesting about this cancer is that other than the tumor cells that you can see in these areas, there are also infiltrating lymphocytes that goes around either in the stroma or within the tumor itself. And this has allowed the initial classification of this cancer to be what we call the lymphoepithelocarcinomas because of the dense infiltrating lymphocytes that is seen commonly in these cancers. But just of note, the tumor is actually from the epithelial cells and not from the lymphocytes. With standard H&E, now with new technology, we can do multiplex IHC staining. As you can see, we can have a very variety of colors that can be depict certain molecules that you want to characterize for this tumor. And because of the rich infiltrating lymphocytes, studies have looked at certain population of lymphocytes that's infiltrating into the NPC cells. So for instance, you look at the CD3 positive, which is a marker for T cells. And you can see in our own series and also in other publications, you can see that patients who have a very dense CD3 positive T cells do far better in terms of survival rather than patients who have a poorer, lower density of CD3 positive infiltrates, suggesting that these T cells are there likely to kill these cancers that's harboring the virus. So when we look at the clinical outcomes of this cancer, this was a publication almost 7 years ago, where we look at a retrospective cohort of about 560 NPC patients in the Multi Ethics Society in Singapore. What we found from this study, which is fairly similar with other published data in China or other parts of the world, essentially we see that overall survival across all stages approaches approximately 60%. And the disease-specific survival will approach about 75%. And when we break down this in terms of the different ethnic population, we did not find any significant differences either in the overall survival or the disease-specific survival, either between the Chinese population and the non-Chinese population, suggesting that the biology of this cancer is slightly similar across the different races. Similarly, when we do a multivariate analysis, patients who have a N2, N3 disease, M1 disease certainly do poorer in terms of disease-specific survival and overall survival. We did not find that a T classification was independent predictor for survival, at least in this series that we have. So the summary for the epidemiology of this cancer is that this is primarily EBV driven in the endemic countries such as Asia. And the diagnosis is performed using the standard H&E diagnosis. And EBA is a nearly confirmatory because more than 95% of this cancer are EBV positive. The risk factors will include smoking, dietary choice of salted food, and the role of susceptibility to the EBV will need to be ascertained with larger cohorts. Next, I would like to move on to the cell-free DNA diagnosis for cancer. This is a nice summary of this technology recently in the New England Journal of Medicine. in summary, I mean, you can see from this this figure, I would like to focus primarily on the peripheral blood, but certainly you can detect all this cell-free DNA across many different kinds of body fluids. If you look at the principles of this liquid biopsies, you can see that when the tumor either go through apoptosis or necrosis, they will then secrete their fragments into the blood circulation. And these fragments can then be detected using highly sensitive assays. And the fragments can be either circulating cell-free DNA, exosomes, or circulating tumor cells, depending on how this was detected. Some key points in terms of diagnosing of this cancer is that these are typically 150 to 200 base pairs, double-stranded. They have a very short half-life of less than 1 hour, and the amount may be variable depending the temperature, the time of collection. And certainly the amount that you see right here is a fragment of the total amount of cell-free DNA in the blood. As you can see, you can either detect known mutation of cancers, you can even detect copy number alterations, gene fusions, and epigenetic changes. So these are just to highlight some of the potential clinical application for this technology. It can either use in screening for early detection, identifying minimal residual disease after treatment, and also for monitoring of responses, and therefore identify clonal resistant clones of tumor cells in the circulation. And finally, it can also be used for surveillance purposes in terms of early detection or relapses. So how does this can be used in terms of treatment algorithm stratification? Certainly in terms of treatment de-escalation, assuming that the patient have undetectable cell-free DNA after treatment, then there may be a potential strategy to de-intensify treatment. And conversely, if patients have detectable cell-free DNA, then adjuvant treatment in the form of adjuvant chemotherapy can be administered in this context. So for at least for MPC, these are some of the existing assays that are available to detect EBV. I would like to primarily focus on cell-free DNA against the BAM HIW fragment of the EBV virus. So this is recently reviewed by our group looking at the utility of this technology and other liquid biopsy in MPC. I'd like to focus primarily on the cell-free DNA technologies in this talk. So I'd like to highlight this paper published in National Cancer Center where they compare a panel of EBV liquid biopsies, either using CTCs or cell-free DNA, either against the EBNA1 or the BAMW HIW fragments. And from this case control series, they found that the EBV against the BAM HIW fragment has improved sensitivity for EBV detection. And what summarizes in this is that the sensitivity when you use the BAM HI fragment, particularly targeting at the CpG repeats of this EBV genome, they were able to show a sensitivity detection of 89%. And when you target another component of the EBV genome, the sensitivity drops to 67%. Certainly across the stage of cancer, you can see from stage 1 to stage 4, as the disease burden goes larger, there are also larger quantities of this cell-free DNA can be detected, demonstrating that this is a fairly sensitive assay to detect that correlates well with disease burden in the patient. So what have transpired since is that we found that the group in Hong Kong found that the group in Hong Kong found that the longer fragment of the DNA that is detected are primarily arising from MPC patients than non-MPC subjects. As you can see, as the base pair of detection goes higher, majority of this detection of EBV comes from cancer patients than from non-cancer subjects. So with that, this is just to highlight the difference in assay. This is the NEJM paper from Hong Kong where you use their technology to detect this virus. A false positive of 5% was found in this series. And that's because the applicon, the size of this DNA detection was lower, about 67 base pair, compared to the MPC gold that is commercially available because of a longer applicon size. the false positive rate, at least for this series, was 0%. So how do we then use this assay to avoid the situation that we sometimes see in our practice where patient has locally advanced, widely metastatic MPC that is refractory to further treatment? So some of the, and other strategies will include whether we could use this to detect fairly early MPC, such as in this case, that's picked up purely incidentally on nasal endoscopy for an unrelated END complaint. So just to highlight this paper that was shown earlier, this was a publication coming out from Hong Kong where they tested a community setting, about 20,000 patients, and using a serial 2-positive EBV DNA detection 4 weeks apart, about 1.5 of the community have detectable EBV virus. And they used, when they screened for this population, only 34 patients were confirmed with MPC. But what is noteworthy is that those patients they were detected using screening were mainly in the stage 1 and stage 2 cohort, and their 3-year performance progression-free survival was certainly much higher compared to a historic cohort of 70% for early stage 1 and 2 disease, highlighting the value of screening in MPC in this particular situation. I'd like to highlight this particular case. This cancer was detected just at this point, an MRI demonstrating a very small tumor underneath the fossa of Rosamunda. So we can see using this detection, there is a negative predictive value of nearly 100%, meaning that if the patient has a negative EBV detection, it is highly unlikely the patient would have MPC at that particular point of screening. The other aspects that can be used is in terms of personalization of therapy. This is a graph that we typically like to see after seeing our patients through chemoradiotherapy. So this patient has a locally advanced MPC, and upon completion of the treatment, you can see undetectable EBV following definitive treatment. So this led to a question that was done by Hong Kong, where they randomized patients with detectable EBV after completion of standard concurrent chemoradiotherapy, either into receiving adjuvant chemotherapy or just clinical observation in this cohort. So they have about 52 patients in each arm. And what they demonstrated, at least from survival analysis, is that there is no difference in terms of whether patients receive adjuvant chemo or observations. So whether the patients are randomized to each arm, there was no significant survival advantage for administering additional chemotherapy after concurrent chemoradiotherapy. But what was important and what was relevant, a positive finding in this study, was that when they incorporate the EBV titers into the Kaplan-Meier survival curve, you can see when they stratify according to the stage 2, stage 3, and 4, there is well separation of survival curve. But when they incorporated the EBV values, the pre-treatment values into post-treatment EBV values into this curve, you can see there is greater separation or sensitivity in terms of separating out the different populations according to the EBV titers, either 1 to 49, 50 to 500, and more than 500 copies of the chemoradiotherapy, something that is unique. So with this finding, I think other groups have looked at how can we incorporate the plasma EBV into the standard 8 AJCC EBV staging, MPC staging. And they look at, when you look at a cutoff of 500 copies, they found that incorporating the EBV plasma into the AJCC staging system outperforms the standard AJCC staging system in terms of better separation of the survival across stages with the incorporation of EBV. Another group from Sun Yat-sen look at big data, and they look at the spontaneous remission of residual post-treatment plasma EBV and how does this prognosticate this group of patients. So they divided patients into 3 groups. The first group has undetectable EBV after treatment. Second group has detectable EBV but spontaneously regressed within 3 months. And the third group has persistently detectable EBV beyond 3 months. And you can see there are good separation in terms of the disease-free survival and the distant metastasis-free survival, indicating that patients who have detectable EBV after treatment are certainly at higher risk for relapses. So in terms of monitoring of treatment, this was the early paper where they look at the use of EBV in terms of monitoring how the patient respond to treatment. You can see there is a good correlation in terms of the decrease of this liquid biopsy following treatment. So how does this pan out in real world data? I mean, surveillance for the clinical examples. I mean, these are not some clinical examples that I hope to illustrate the role of plasma EBV in terms of local regional relapse and distant relapses. So for instance, this is a patient who has locally advanced NPC treated with concurrent chemoradiotherapy. And he had a recurrence in the frontal sinus, which was biopsy proven. And then he had another cause of chemo RT. And after 5 months post-treatment, the MRI showed this rounded lymph nodes in the neck. And after discussing at our tumor board, we felt that this node was suspicious because of the morphology, even though it's small. We elected to excise it, and it turned out that it is negative for cancers. And just of note that the plasma EBV of this patient was negative. The second patient is a patient who had completed chemoradiotherapy about 7 years ago and had at diagnosis had bilateral retropharyngeal lymph node that was positive on the PET. 4 years after treatment, a surveillance MRI scan pick up a new recurrent right retropharyngeal node right here, and nasopharynx looked entirely normal. So the PET scan about 4 months later showed that this node was avid, as you can see in this scan. At that point, it was difficult to make a clear recommendation, so the options of either surveillance or surgery was put out to the patient. The patient eventually elected for observation, and you can see this is when the EBV was undetectable, and about 4 to 6 months later, you can see an interval increase in the size of lymph node, and at this point, the EBV was 1,700 copies, suggesting that this node is slightly pathological and probably gives us more confidence to offer surgery, particularly in this patient. The reason for that is that retropharyngeal lymph node is usually quite inaccessible. You can see this was taken not from an NPC patient, but for a patient with oral pharynx. We can illustrate that the anatomy of this retropharyngeal space is highly challenging and technically challenged to get at in the absence of a open mandibulotomy or a maxillary swing approach. So I think the EBV plasma does help us in a way to counsel patients in this particular setting. So to summarize, the diagnosis of NPC, at least in endemic countries, is ubiquitous EBV driven, and therefore it offers opportunities for early detection, for recurrence, screening, and prognostication. Currently, more sensitive assays are developing. I think other countries are also looking at newer techniques such as a nasopharyngeal brush, and this certainly can be used to be explored and to help to detect some of these early recurrences. With that, I'd like to thank my collaborators and colleagues in Singapore, and happy to take any question at the end of this webinar. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Ming Lim, for the very clear and informative presentation. So I assume that there will be a lot of questions for Professor Ming Lim after this. Don't forget to write on it in the questions sections, Q&A sections, okay? So now it is turn for me to introduce the second speaker. The second speaker is Professor Johanna Patricia Canal, and she will talk about the treatment of NPC, and she is the professor of radiology and radiation oncology, University of the Philippines, Manila College of Medicine. And also she is a fellow of Philippines College of Radiology, Honorary Fellow, Philippine Society of Otolaryngology, Head and Neck Surgery. So, Professor Johanna, time is yours.
Thank you. Allow me to share my screen. Okay, good evening, everyone. I will take a few minutes to go through quickly the treatment for nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Now, good evening to everyone again. This is sunset picture from the Philippines. I have no financial disclosures, but I think this is an appropriate time to disclose that it is nasopharyngeal carcinoma that probably made me into a radiation oncologist. It has always intrigued me. So we continue. This was already discussed earlier, the epidemiology. So I will skip over that. Unfortunately, they have numbers for China, Indonesia, Vietnam, India, Malaysia. Nasopharyngeal carcinoma is fairly common in the Philippines, but we still haven't gotten the numbers, the exact numbers. We just know that there are a lot of patients here. Okay, now, still the most used guideline when looking at the treatment for nasopharyngeal carcinoma is the NCCN guideline. Now, if you look through the newest version, the 2021 version, it actually really just contains 4 pages of recommendation. But if you look at the standard textbooks of radiation oncology, our Bible, what we call our Bible, Paris and Brady, has 109 pages just on nasopharyngeal carcinoma, which just emphasizes the importance of radiation treatment in nasopharyngeal carcinoma. In the standard otolaryngology textbook, Harrison, there are 47 pages. So even if it's so much less than radiotherapy, still it is so much more than what NCCN has. Now, there was a time when the standard for treatment for for nasopharyngeal carcinoma was just radiotherapy. I think I'm going to date myself when I say this. But if you look at this, it's an old study, 1989. The 10-year survival rate for patients with nasopharyngeal carcinoma, for stage 1 and 2, it was just 41.5%. And for stage 3 and 4, it was really just 22.8%. So these rates were dismal. Chemotherapy at the time was just used for metastatic disease. But that was long ago. See, sadly, I still remember the time when we used to do this. We would use x-rays to take images of our patient, then we would draw on the x-rays. So obviously, the treatment was not very precise. But for that time, for the time that we did this, this was available and appropriate. At that time, we used only photons. Nowadays, it is different. But if you'll see, we go back there. This came out, Intergroup Study 99, the ALSARAF protocol. And this changed things in the way we treat nasopharyngeal carcinoma. This was in 1998. Another thing that came out that became more ubiquitous was the linear accelerator. Remember there was a time that prior to this, we would use cobalt machines. Now with the linear accelerator, we were able to become more precise. And we are able to do this now. So today, because of the linear accelerators that we use, we can still do two-dimensional treatment, but we can additionally do three-dimensional treatment, IMRT or intensity modulated treatment, and now IGRT, which is image-guided treatment. Okay. Now, today, our capability for precision is unparalleled. Because of the advances in digital imaging, because we are able to do high-resolution CT, MR, maybe I should have included their PET, and fusion of these images. Nowadays, it has become so important for the images to be beautiful, to be as precise, and to pick up as much as possible. I remember the time in the 80s and the 90s when our CT scans could not do this, could not come up with high resolution images. And our computers were very, very low in memory. it could not compute fast enough. And our radiation delivery, as I mentioned earlier, was really just cobalt. See, there really is no point in doing precise treatment if precise imaging is not available. And conversely, there was really no point in doing precise imaging if we couldn't treat them precisely anyway. So it's all these advances in digital technology that is allowing us to do what we do today. Now, if you compare the image on your left, where it shows conventional treatment, the line that is in yellow shows that it is that whole area, everything inside that yellow loop gets 7,000 centigrade. That is what happened when we were able to treat using two-dimensional treatment. So there was only a certain fixed area that got 7,000. But now with the image on your right, since we are able to, in a sense, shape the beams to make precise treatment areas, if you will note, the loop of yellow is now more confined to the area that really requires the radiation, the area of the tumor. If you will notice, there are squiggly shapes that are in light blue. Those are the contours for the parotid glands. So in the image on the left, our parotid glands were obviously given the same dose as the nasopharynx. Hence, we had patients who could not, who had dry mouths and could not taste anything. Whereas with new conformal treatments, we can decrease the dose to the parotid significantly so that our patients, after treatment, can live near normal, near back to normal lives. Now, radiation today is given concurrently with chemotherapy in most cases. And if you look at the 10-year survival, you will note that if you will look at this, T1, T2, and T3 were 94.2, 92.5, and 91.4%. So even that of T4 disease, even if it is only 79.3, it is still higher than the 10-year survival rates of long ago. So obviously, the more precise radiation therapy and the addition of chemotherapy has resulted in significant leaps in the management of nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Now, we're not saying that the treatment is easier for the patient. No. Honestly, it is more difficult for some patients. The addition of chemotherapy will really open up the patient for more side effects. But then the results cannot be denied. The results, they speak for themselves. They're very, very good. So in general, if you had the choice, image-guided radiotherapy is better than intensity-modulated radiotherapy, is better than 3D conformal radiotherapy, and is definitely better than 2D. I'm fairly sure that there are still some countries where 2D is available because, remember, those are still the workhorses. Well, to me, that's better than nothing. But really, if you can do it, do the IMRT, do the IGRT. But as I mentioned earlier, the imaging requirements are also higher. If you are to use image-guided radiotherapy, then obviously your images will have to be better. You will have to use high-resolution CT scans, your 64 slices, 128 slices, 256 slice CT scan as a basis. Better if you have an MRI, better if you have a PET, and best if you can fuse all these images together. So that to the radiation oncologist, to all the oncologists, we know what the enemy looks like. We know what we have to do. So we go back to the NCCN guidelines. I think this is page one of one of four. If you will look at the T1 NOMO, it really is definitive RT to the nasopharynx. And that's it. Nothing more. If you will look at T1 to T4 with neck nodes, the minute you have neck nodes, you can introduce chemotherapy. And then if there is a metastatic disease, again, it is chemotherapy and radiotherapy. So actually, the only time that you don't have to add chemotherapy is for T1 NOMO. But then again, if you think about it, how many of our patients really present to us with this low stage of nasopharyngeal carcinoma? Very, very few. It's still very common for patients to present with nosebleed. But then the patients who present to us with headaches, with neck nodes, with vision problems, obviously they are no longer candidates for just radiotherapy. We will have to use both. There is this one page out of the four. This is page 404 in the NCCN guidelines that lists the possible chemotherapy agents that can be used. And the most common still in use is cisplatin. But if you will look through it, you can use docetaxel, 5-FU, and gemcitabine. Those are still being used. Although, as I said, cisplatin is still the most, a platinum-based chemotherapy is still the most common. Now, if you will look at the right side, there is immunotherapy, which is pembro and nivolumab. I've asked my medical oncology colleagues, when would they use pembro for nasopharyngeal carcinoma? Because the studies that have come out regarding pembro are actually quite tantalizing in that the results are very, very good. But as of now, because it is category 2B, they would still just use it for recurrent and metastatic nasopharyngeal CA. So still, their first choice is a platinum-based chemotherapy. If it is possible, if there are no contraindications in the patient, then that's where they will go. Now, so I'm going towards the end of the lecture. What is next? What we have to do now is make sure that the better intensity modulated and image guided radiotherapy is more widely available. We will have to admit that there are problems all over the region in providing this kind of high technology radiotherapy. Even in the Philippines, these machines will tend to be in the big cities so that there is access becomes an issue. There are, as far as I know, there are still a couple of cobalt machines in the Philippines, mainly because they are cheap to maintain and easy to use, but we really should be moving away from those. There are also cobalt machines in other ASEAN countries. Again, because maintenance is much easier. But then, yes, we should be moving towards the more precise treatments. Why is that? Because we don't want to induce as many side effects as we used to. Now, our patients survive a long time. As I showed earlier, the 10-year survival rates are very, very good. Now, I made a cursory check of the charts of my old patients. Actually, none of them died within the first year or after radiotherapy. My longest surviving patient was 11 years after a T4 with intracranial spread. So this patient came to me blind in one eye with obvious intracranial involvement, and we treated this patient, and 11 years later, he died 11 years later from pneumonia. So it nasopharyngeal carcinoma is survivable. That's why we want to use as precise radiotherapy as possible, because we now have to look at quality of life. If our survival rates are better, we should be looking at quality of life of these patients. Now, de-escalation. The first lecture mentioned de-escalation because, of course, we would like to look into that. We don't want to burden the patients with long, expensive treatments, but we're not there yet. We still have to do more studies, more research into that. But nowadays, what's nice is that we have more options for the management of side effects. Side effects in radiotherapy are a long recognized problem, so there are more options available. But yeah, we would still prefer that the patients not develop as many side effects in the first place. So in this, I think this is the last slide. Thank you very much. I will be available for questions after this set of lectures. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prof. Joanna, for your presentations that, of course, will broaden the horizons of the radiations or the especially the treatments of the NPC. So it is the turn for me to introduce my previous boss in the ASNO, Professor Sheng Po Hao. He will give a talk about the surgical treatment of NPC, but he is also a head and neck and skull-based surgeon from Taiwan. And he is a real expert of salvage nasopharyngectomy for residual or recurrent NPC. And he was the Myers Lectures in 2014 and also recognized as one of the master in the head and neck surgery by IFNOS in 2018, but also past presidents of ASNO. So Professor Sheng Po Hao, it's time for you to present the surgical treatment of NPC.
So thank you, Marinda, for your kind introduction. I'm really honored to join this webinar of ASEAN Head and Neck Network, episode 7, management of NPC. Mando will be talking about the surgical management, surgical treatment of nasopharyngeal carcinoma. And I'm from Taiwan. Right now I work for the Xinguang Wuhos Memorial Hospital in Taiwan, in Taipei. My topic today is about NPC, especially the surgical treatment. So first of all, I think Joanna has talked with us, the conventional treatment for NPC would be chemoradiation therapy. So definitely it is not a surgical disease. NPC is not a surgical disease. However, why the NPC patient should be treated with radiation therapy? I guess, first of all, the tumor is a very radio responsive tumor. So it responds very well to radiation therapy. And also in the past, there is no adequate surgical margins in nasopharynx. That means you very difficult to have a negative surgical margin, you know, when you do a nasopharyngectomy. However, that's before the era of cranial-based surgery. And of course, we treat NPC primarily with chemoradiation therapy. However, if we have a local recurrence in the nasopharynx, what should we do for the patient? I think basically we have two options. The first would be salvage scopic surgery, and the second would be re-irradiation. However, in my mind, I think there is no reason to really believe that the tumor would respond, which failed the initial radiation therapy, would respond to the second course of radiation therapy. So as an ENT, as a head and neck surgeon, we try to do the salvage nasopharyngectomy for residual or recurrent NPC. So before we talking about the nasopharyngectomy, I think I'm going to talk about the role of ENT doctor in the management of NPC. I think first of all, based on you know, Chumin's talk, we are going to screening, do the screening and do the diagnosis of NPC, especially based on the EBV virology to diagnose the NPC early. And And then we need to, as an ENT surgeon, we need to stage the patient either with CT, MRI, or with the recent advancement of the PET. And then the treatment based on the NCCN guideline. I think Joanna has shared with us her opinion on this. And then as an ENT surgeon, I think we are we should be able to manage some of the complications, especially the osteoradial necrosis, which is very common in the old days, especially when you know, the radiation oncologist treat the patient with a cobalt machine. And then lastly, as a surgeon, we should be able to do salvage surgery for recurrent or residual MPC patient, especially in the primary site, in the nasopharynx. However, we are talking about the salvage surgery for recurrent MPC. I think, first of all, I have to admit that there is a paradigm shift in scar-based surgery, in head and neck surgery as well. That is from open to endoscopic. That means we really opened up everything and try to remove the tumor, which carries a lot of complications. And in nowadays, we might be able to select the case and shift the surgical approaches from open to endoscopic. So that's the paradigm shift. And then I'll talk about just a little bit to echo what Chumin said. I think EPV would be a very, very good tumor marker in the MPC diagnosis. It could be used for general screening, could be used for monitoring the recurrence. And of course, using the cell-free or plasma, the so-called EBV DNA load, we will be able to early diagnose the recurrence. However, once you have elevated DNA, EBV DNA load after the chemo radiation therapy, we still need to know where is the recurrence. So we still need to have a PET for the patient to localize the recurrence. And then, of course, every case, you know, no matter it's a local recurrence or residual cancer or recurrent cancer, there should be a biopsy proved for further nasopharyngectomy. And so for the salvage nasopharyngectomy, I think, again, EBV is a very useful marker to close monitor the patient, especially after radiation therapy. And we should be able to use the EBV as a marker to diagnose the recurrence early and try to treat them early. And then to deal with the salvage nasopharyngectomy, I think in the past, we have several approaches, external approaches, such as maxillary screen. And in nowadays, a robotics could be coupled to the maxillary screen for nasopharyngectomy and some others. For myself, I love to use the facial translocation approach. We will talk about this just a little bit, some minutes later. And then for intracranial invasion, we should be able to do the craniofacial resection. And also there are some small, you know, opening approaches such as transparotal, transmandibular level one osteotomy in the past. However, this kind of approaches has been mostly abandoned in nowadays because this is only for very small recurrence, especially only do for in the central part of the nasopharynx. So that is not really give the surgeon a big wide enough exposure. And then of course, you know, in recent years, we kind of select the cases for endoscopic approaches. And then for this, for example, this is a nasopharyngeal carcinoma patient after radiation therapy and have a small recurrence over the left nasopharynx. And of course, we could using the maxillary screen approaches, which is, you know, popularized by Professor William Wei. And however, to screen the anterior cheek bone and soft tissue laterally to expose the nasopharynx and do the nasopharyngectomy. However, our maxillary screen approach would be just a little different from the Professor Wei's approach because we don't really split the upper lip and we don't really split the palate to avoid the palatal fistula afterwards. And then for me, I love to use the so-called facial translocation approaches This approach has been developed by Professor Zeneca in 1989, some 30 years ago, and so this approach has been popularized to recognize as one of the best approaches for anterior central skull base. It's really involved a modular craniofacial bone disassembly and could really provide excellent surgical field for anterior skull base and middle cranial base, and of course including the nasopharynx. And so this cartoon basically show you each facial skeleton could be removed temporarily just for surgical approaches. And after the resection procedure, you could actually put every piece of bone back and regain the patient cosmesis and as far as the patient's function. So the picture show how the initial description of facial translocation approaches. And you could see this facial translocation approaches could be combined with some new surgical approaches. For example, a subfrontal approach or for a subtemporal approaches to approach the middle cranial base area. And this is a good example. This is not the case of recurrent MBC, but this is the case of a fresh mucoepidermoid carcinoma over the depth nasopharynx. And we will be able to use the facial translocation approach to remove the tumor. So the facial skeleton was skeletonized and then temporarily removed and to approach the posterior part of the nasal cavity, and the neurosurgeon did a subtemporal craniotomy to protect the petrous internal carotid artery, and we will be able to remove the whole tumor. So that's the merit of the facial translocation approaches. However, we don't really see so many big tumor. And instead, we have some experience in using the facial translocation approaches for especially for a recurrent MBC. For example, this is a case of a recurrent MBC over the right lower medial fossa, and the corner cut, you can see the tumor really approach to the foramen ovale area. And this is a very good case for facial translocation. And just basically show you just a lateral neurotomy incision and skeletonize the facial skeleton. And you don't really need to remove a large piece of facial bone. Instead, you could only remove a very small piece of the facial skeleton here, and this the bone removed, and then you sound up, create a nasal wall flap, and the flap could be used later to resurface the inner defect of the facial skeleton. And then after the approach, after a medium mastectomy, you could actually approach to the nasopharynx and do your nasopharyngectomy. And then in the reconstructive procedure, you just drill some holes along the free edge of the facial skeleton. And then you develop a lateral nasal wall flap, which is anterior based on the anterior nasal artery. And then the bone graft was secured with three-point fixation to the remaining bone. And then the mucosa flap was used to lay inside the defect of the facial skeleton. And it was fixed, a three-point fixation, and then the wound was closed. So usually we have a very good surgical result after this. The initial publication, 38 recurrent MBC patient, the 3-year survival will be 61%, 3-year local control will be 76%. And usually we could have a very good functional and cosmetic results after the modified facial translocation approaches. For example, this beautiful lady, you could barely see the facial scar here, and then the eye is open in the equal weight. And then I think the cosmesis and the function would be very, very good. However, we do see some patient, just like this lady, because of the patient has been heavily irradiated. And then, so when you put the bone back, the bone graft availability will be a question. And then again, you incise the patient's face. So there's always a facial scar, and the facial scar will give the patient some psychiatric impact as well. So this is the pitfall of the facial translocation. So we kind of try to avoid the bone graft from necrosis. We kind of developing anteriorly based latent nasal wall mucosa flap and use this flap to resurface the translocated inner defect of the translocated facial bone segment, so that to prevent the postoperative radial necrosis of the bone graft. So this is the paper published some years ago, and using this kind of nasal wall flap, we could actually avoid the facial skeleton to be necrotic. And then because when we do open approaches for the patient, although the functional and cosmetic result would be very, very good, however, they still have some, psychiatric impact to the patient, because we really create some, facial scar in the patient's face. So why don't we approach the nasopharyngectomy with some endoscopic approach, which is the paradigm shift. In head and neck surgery, paradigm shift in scopic surgery in nasopharyngectomy, which is from open to endoscopic approaches. So just talk about some, technique, point in the endoscopic nasopharyngectomy. And first of all, we know the endoscope, you just take a telescope into the nasal cavity, so you could have a very good visualization and to see the surgical field, and you will be able to control the breathing under endoscope. And of course, if you have a tumor approaching the scopes, you will be able to use the navigation system to help you to do the endoscopic resection. And of course, we got two nostrils, so it's better to use the so-called binostrial four hands technique, so that you could have your assistant to grasp the tumor and to have some traction. So you could use one hand with your scope and one hand hold the instrument and to do the dissection of the base of the tumor. And then to start the nasopharyngectomy, I think it's very important to first to create the so-called corridor, the operation field, so that you may consider cutting the middle turbinate or inferior turbinate, and even the posterior septum, so that you could from a right nose or from the left nasal chamber, you could see each side of the nasopharynx. That's good for your nasopharyngectomy. And to control the breathing, always ligate the ipsilateral sphenoparotid artery. That give you a much less breathing and a clean surgical field. And then you just look for the sphenoid recess and remove the mucosa to find the sphenoid os. And then you cut the eustachian tube as far later as possible. And then you join your lower and contralateral mucosa cut. And basically you could remove the mucosa of the pharyngeal basilar fascia, and usually the NPCs could be limited by the pharyngeal basilar fascia, and this fascia is a very strong fascia, so that you could actually use this fascia as a a barrier for as a, your deep surgical margin. So always use this to send the pharyngeal basilar fascia as your deep surgical margin. And then you do the bone cut as necessary. That's for the scar-based bone invasion case. Sometimes you need to use the navigation system and to help you to do the bone cut and to approach into the intracranial portion. And to because usually the recurrence mostly resides not in the in the center of the nasopharynx, but usually either in the right side or left side approaching the so-called sinus mucani. So you really need to cut the eustachian tube cartilage as far later as possible. Try to include the whole northern minor fossa, so that try to send the frozen section over the most later part of the nasopharyngectomy. That's some of the technical points for endoscopic nasopharyngectomy. And then, so just a small series, in the past, 12 years, we have around 20 personality. I have around 24 recurrent NPC, a patient underwent endoscopic nasopharyngectomy, and 19 cases were actually up to one course of chemo radiation therapy, and then 5 cases underwent 2 courses. And some cases with scar-based invasion, so we really need to use the navigation assistance to facilitate endoscopic resection. And the results, initial surgical margin were all negative, so there is no immediate postoperative radiation therapy indicated. And then the follow-up time is here. It means around 4 years, and we have very good local control, around 83%. And however, we do see some patients still have scar-based osteoradionecrosis, and the 3-year overall survival is around 88%. And for example, this is another case of a recurrent NPC here. You can see the ugly tumor here. And then we could use the endoscope to see the tumor and then to resect the mucosa, do the posterior septectomy, remove the posterior part of the septum so that, and then you remove the mucosa, strip the mucosa down to see the pharyngopatient fascia and use the pharyngopatient fascia as your deep surgical margin and remove the whole nasopharynx. So that basically that's the endoscopic nasopharyngectomy. And we don't really reconstruct the defect. The defect was left for secondary healing, usually heal very well up to 3 to 6 months. And for this case, he has been operated actually 20 years now and has been well until now. So some other theories about endoscopic nasopharyngectomy, I think if we just dealing with T1 or T2 cases, I think the survival, 2-year survival would be more than 80% in every series. And if you could get a negative surgical margin. And of course, we sometimes will see intracranial invasion recurrence like this. And certainly you need to do a conventional craniofacial resection for the patient. And so just some of the prognosis for the, so this based on my previous paper published in APCA of 57 patients. So you could see in 57 patients, we are not only dealing with a small recurrence, T1 or T2, we also deal with some scar-based bone invasion patient or even a T4 intracranial invasion patient. And the 5-year survival, local 5-year local control, 54%, 5-year overall survival around 53%. I think if you could do a good nasopharyngectomy, the 5-year survival would be very, very, very reasonable. It's all around 30 to 50%. And some of the prognosticator, we did the multivariate analysis of the local recurrence, and we find that the margin status is very important to determine if the patient would have, the second local recurrence. So I'll try to pursue the negative surgical margin. And we also find that if the patient subsequently develop a neck recurrence or presented with a simultaneous neck recurrence, then the local recurrence rate is also higher than not. And then for the overall survival multivariate analysis, again, if the patient could not get a negative surgical margin, it's doomed to have local recurrence, and then the survival would be poor. And in conclusion, as 57 recurrent NPC patient under an nasopharyngectomy, including T1 to T4, not only T1, but also including T3 and T4 patient, we could have a 5-year local control, 54% impact factor, including margin, especially the margin status. And then the 5-year overall survival is around 53%. The important impact factor to for the survival would be a secondary local recurrence. And if you have a secondary local recurrence, for sure you are going to give the patient some adjuvant treatment. So, and then that's also give the patient negative impact. And look at some other series. Professor William Wei published. This is 246 patients of recurrent MPC after maxillary nasopharyngectomy. And he also stressed that the independent factors for survival would be a negative surgical margin, and of course the tumor size. So that's the T1 or T4 tumor. So try to pursue for a negative surgical margin and try to find the recurrence early and treat the early recurrence. That will give you a patient a better survival. So the strategy for recurrent MPC currently in my practice, we would be for recurrent T1 or limited scar-based invasion, we would do endoscopic resection. For intracranial invasion, we would do a cranial facial resection for sure. Later extension to the scar base, media to the foramen ovale, we will do a modified facial translocation. And for parapharyngeal space involvement, you may send a patient for second course of chemo radiation therapy. We used to do subtemporal approaches. However, for this group of patients, the survival would be 5-year survival is only around 30%, and with serious complications. So right now we would send the patient for second course of chemo radiation therapy again. And of course, now the robotics come into the market, and robotic nasopharyngectomy has been reported using the transoral approach, transparato or mangoentral approaches. The merits of the robotics, of course, it could give you a very good assistance for better contour traction and easy dissection, especially over the tumor base. However, for the robotics, it's a very huge machine. The robotic Da Vinci arms are really too bulky and there is no working space. So, for robotic, it could not really reach the superior exposure for the scorpus will be very, very poor. So you still need endoscopic approaches for the scorpus. So there is no sole robotic nasopharyngectomy at this moment. However, in recent years, the so-called single port robotics came into the market, and this might really help the nasopharyngectomy. But again, this could not be covered with some bone work. So still, you need to have an endoscope to help you if the tumor really reached the scar-based bone. And of course, there are some flexible endoscope coming into the market, and this could give us some tools to do the nasopharyngectomy. However, I think this is not very popular in Asia. And so I just give you some take-home message. There is a law for salvage surgery in nasopharyngectomy. I think salvage nasopharyngectomy for recurrent MPC or for residual MPC is the procedure is very safe and should be a feasible procedure. However, the patient selection is very important. Select a good patient for a good surgery, and there is a paradigm shift from open to endoscopic, and local control and survival will be around 50%. Prostonicator, most important, negative surgical margin. So try to look for negative surgical margins. So I'm going to stop my talk here, and thank you for your attention. Thank you. And just a small virtual, hongbao. So Happy New Year to everyone.
Happy New Year.
Yeah, I forgot to say Happy New Year. Thank you very much, Prof. Cheng Pohao, for your interesting and informative lectures. So I just would like to tell you all that we have almost 450 participants. So
wow.
Nice. It's a big participant. So please feel free to fill in or to write the questions. And then after this, we will have discussions with the very with the presenter and the panelists. So now it's time for me to call the panelists to give comments or thought about our topics or what presenter already give a presentations. So the first panelist is Professor Avatar or Dr. Avatar Singh Mohan Singh is a consultant otorhinolaryngology head and neck surgeon in Taiping Hospital, Ministry of Health, Malaysia. Please, Dr. Avatar.
Yeah. Okay. Good evening, all, and thank you, Malinda, for the kind introduction. Right. That was an excellent talk. I'm sure all will agree by our three presenters, Professor Chiming, Professor Joanna, and Professor Sheng Po. And as we know, that NPC is an endemic cancer in this region, Southeast Asia, and Malaysia is one of it. And that's why I think when we brought about this topic, it's excellent here. In fact, in Malaysia, the National Cancer Registry of Malaysia in 2016, the latest one, the 5 years from 2012 to 2016, stated that NPC was the fifth most common cancer in the country after breast cancer, colorectal, lung, and also then was nasopharyngeal. And among the head and neck cancer, NPC was the number one. And which goes to say also, when we look at our data in hospital, Taiping Hospital for the last 5 years from 2016 to 2020, we had about 64 patients, right? And it was the number one cancer, followed by CA larynx. And to see that is, we pick up about one case a week. And the sad part is that most of them, about 50% of them, are at stage four. So even though, yes, the treatment is getting advanced and all that, but I guess what is lacking is education towards our population. Our population is to be educated of the symptoms and all that, about neck swelling, unilateral hearing loss, epistaxis or bloodstained sputum. That is what is lacking, even though the treatment is going forward, because we are still getting a lot of patients at stage four. So for that reason, right, I'd like to share to you this. This was a CPG, which was brought out by Ministry of Health Malaysia in collaboration with our ENT society, that is MSOHNS, in 2016. Okay, as you can see, that it's a CPG, and it's meant for all the health givers in Malaysia, and especially so the general practitioners in the district, so that NPC can be detected early and can be treated. Because, like mentioned just now, it can be treated. And if it's caught at stage one, the survival rate, as all of us know, for 5 years is almost 90%. So this was done in 2016, and I'm sure Dr. Shempo will know, it was led by our Dr. Hua Kin Chu from Penang, and she was very passionate about it. So this was that. Okay, so rest in that. I think overall we are heading towards the right direction over in the treatment care and also the education. We are trying to do that. I think that's the most important thing. Right. Thank you.
Thank you, Prof. Dr. Avatar, for the a comment on your thought about this, the three speakers and about the topics today. So now I would like to ask Professor Chokchai Mitetrairut, is a clinical professor in otolaryngology, the former chairman of the Department of Otorhinolaryngology, the former medical director of Siri Raj Hospital, and the former vice president of Mahidol University, Thailand. But he is also the advisor of the Thai Society for Head and Neck Oncology. Please, Professor Chokchai, to give your comment.
Thank you very much, Malinda, for your kind introduction. actually enjoy the topic of our three speakers very much. I believe that your marvelous talk have enlightened the audience on this very important topic. However, I'd like to add a few things on and share our experience in treating NPC in the following points. Firstly, the number of NPC in Thailand, although is it in the endemic high-risk area, is not as high as that in Hong Kong, Southern China, or even in Taiwan. The county incidence for nasopharyngeal cancer is 1.78 new cases per 100,000 population. Meanwhile, it's worth the 2.6 cases per 100,000 in male and 1.100,000 among women. Secondly, although NPC is an Epstein-Barr associated cancer, the pre-treatment EBV DNA detection among Thai patients is only 59.5% or around 60%. Therefore, the use of plasma EBDNA for early detection, those high risk group in our community may not be necessary. It just really monitor or just to tell the prognosis, but for screening it maybe have the low yield on this time. Firstly, NPC is a radiosensitive and chemosensitive tumor, and its location at the scalp bed makes surgery difficult, as Professor Ho had mentioned before. In my point of view, IMRT in conjunction with the chemotherapy are considered a standard of treatment. In our hospital, by treatment by the IMRT in conjunction with the chemotherapy, the 5-year overall survival rate for the stage 1 NPC is over 95%, and stage 2 is 78%, stage 3 is 25%, and stage 4 is 51%. And the treatment outcome depends on the tumor volume and the EBV loss that we monitor after the treatment. And finally, in NPC, the local regional failure for most studies are around 10 to 20% after the radiotherapy. Nasopharyngectomy, as Professor Ho mentioned, could yield a good tumor control due to the advancement in the optical system, but it should be preserved to those early recurrent tumor after the radiotherapy. To consider the radiotherapy again, one should balance between the tumor control probability and the normal tissue complication probability. That's it, what I like to mention today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Chai. It's clear that you give a comment about topics today. So now we are going to proceed with the next program. We have a poll that we are going to share the poll that is contained, I think, three questions that already prepared by the OC. And JJ will share the screen, and the participant, feel free, the attendants, feel free to fill in and just scroll down and fill in. And then we will see the result and we will discuss about this pool. Yes, please. We can start now, the pool. The attendees can fill in the pool now. Just scroll down. There is three questions, I think. How is it? Okay. JJ, everyone's finished already?
Right now it's only 120 people doing the poll.
Okay. We'll wait another minute. Just give them time to fill in all the three questions. We still wait. We're still waiting for the poll. We hope that more people, more attendees fill in the poll that already prepared by the OC. Two minutes more. How is it? I think more people already fill in. JJ? Yeah, so I think, the plasma EBV copies targeting the BAME H1 EBV fragment is clinically useful in all the following clinical scenario of NPC, except, so 44% give answer the screening of community. So I will ask Dr. Chuiming Lim, Prof. Chuiming Lim.
Hi, Melinda, thanks for that. So I put this question, is the answer is actually D. I think certainly plasma EBV helps to prognosticate following treatment, as shown by numerous studies that complements the AGCC staging system. For B, it does help to surveillance for recurrent disease, meaning that if a patient was plasma EBV negative and on surveillance it became positive, then we routinely would do a examination. If nothing is found, we would typically do a PET scan to detect occult metastasis. For C, screening at least is shown in the NEJM paper in Hong Kong that it is useful to screen for early stage 1 and 2 cancer, but the pickup is low, about 1.5% that was screen positive. So I think whether it's implemented on the broad scale based on cost effectiveness needs to be ascertained, but certainly it is useful, but the cost is the consideration. For response D, it does not predict response to current chemo radiotherapy. So the answer is D. Plasma EBV does not predict response to the chemo concurrent chemo radiotherapy. And finally, for E, yes, it does helps to detect minimal residual disease, because we found that patients with persistent detectable plasma EBV following treatment are at higher risk for this, relapses and poorer survival. So it suggests there may be circulating cancer cells within the body, but may not be detectable with current imaging strategies. So the answer is D. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Meng Lim. And then unfortunately, the right answer is only 14%. So, okay. So the second poll. For nasopharyngeal carcinoma, chemotherapy is given concurrently with radiotherapy. I would like to ask Professor Johanna to make a clarification for this poll.
Okay, so the correct answer is letter C in stages 2, 3, and 4. This is written in the NCCN guidelines. Now, why not in all stages? Why there is the issue of overtreatment if you give chemotherapy with stage 1 disease. Remember that both chemo and radiotherapy have potentially very devastating side effects. So we do not want to overtreat also. Now, for locally advanced nasopharyngeal carcinoma, sure, you give concurrent chemo and radiotherapy, but usually there's induction chemotherapy before the concurrent chemo radiotherapy. Well, then obviously D is not correct, not only with certain clinical indications, basically because we give it 4, 2, 3, and 4.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Johanna. I think most of the attendees is, they give the good result there for 64, the good correct answer for the 64%. So congratulations for the second poll. So now we proceed with the third poll. The question is, which of the following descriptions of endoscopic nasopharyngectomy is correct? So I will ask Professor Sheng Po Hao to make a clarification for this. Number three.
Yes, I think the question will be about the technical points of endoscopic nasopharyngectomy. As I have talked about, I think, first of all, we need to do create a corridor for a surgical field. So it's remove the posterior septum, and sometimes even the superior middle terminate turbinectomy, all right? And then, that's create the surgical field. And then so that you could see the tumor better. And even by doing the posterior septectomy, you could see the contralateral nasopharynx, you could see the left side from the right side. So that really help you to do the resection. And then the second would be, may I see my question again?
JJ, could you share the screen again?
And then would be, two nostril four hands technique, which basically would allow you to use your assistant to help you to check the tumor so that it would be better, it would have a better basal dissection, which is most difficult part in nasopharyngectomy. And always use the pharyngobasal fascia as your surgical margin, because most of the time, the pharyngobasal fascia would be a very strong barrier to the tumor spread. I don't operate if the pharyngobasal fascia been infiltrated by the cancer. I don't think we could really have a good surgical margin if the pharyngobasal fascia is really involved or infiltrated. So, and then I think it's very important, to have negative intraoperative frozen section control of surgical margin. So try to pursue for negative surgical margin, which is very important to have a good survival. So the answer of my query here is all the above points are correct. So thank you. 69%, very good.
Thank you, Prof. Sheng Po. So we already discussed about the pool, and then we already getting hot with the discussions. Now we are going to start the discussions, and then I will read. There is a lot of questions, I think. Yeah? There's for the three speakers and the two, and then I will invite the five persons, all the speakers, all the also the panelists to give the answers of the questions from the attendees. So I think this is the first. I think Professor Ming Lip has already answered the earliest time to do the plasma EBV in surveillance of NPC after CCRT. Would you like to answer the questions, Prof. Ming Lip?
So thanks, Melinda. So the typical timing would be 6 to 8 weeks after treatment, because that follows the protocol that was published in the JCO paper in Hong Kong. So people have been using that typically to screen for detectable EBV after treatment.
Okay. So is it also the same with the in Taiwan, Prof. Sheng Po or Professor Johanna in Philippines or in Thailand, Prof. Chok Chai or Afatar in Malaysia? It's same with the 6 to 8 weeks?
Yeah, we typically wait, 4, 6 to 8 weeks after the completion of radiation therapy. And usually the Epstein-Barr virus cell-free DNA load would not be measured after start of radiation therapy for 4 to 6 weeks. And in our experience, if you could detect the cell-free DNA up to 4 to 6 weeks, the radiation therapy, during the radiation therapy up to 4 to 6, up to the start, 4 to 6 weeks, you still have positive EBV DNA, then you have a higher chance to develop a residual cancer or a recurrence.
Thank you. Is there any comment from other speaker or panelists? No? Okay, so we move to the second questions. There is a question that compare EBV DNA titer to IgA, VCA, and EPNOW. What is the, what is your opinion, Ming Lip?
Yeah, so this is a very loaded question because there are many studies looking at comparison. But if we did a nice summary, which I've shared on the information on the summary of the different kind of liquid biopsy for detecting EBV. So it really depends on the context, but I think most studies or most of the data derives from the plasma EBV titers because they have been shown to be highly sensitive and is quantifiable. Whereas the IgA titers are semi-quantitative. So it's a bit harder to impact clinical practice because how do you deal with one patient who have a VCA, one is a 640 and then became one is to 320. So that complicates the clinical decision-making process. So I would think that the plasma EBV would still be something that is more translatable.
Okay. So maybe there is a different things in this, the other countries, maybe in Taiwan, in Thailand, in Philippines or Malaysia. What did you use that for the evaluations maybe?
Unfortunately in the Philippines, EBV titer testing is not... It's not very commonly available. It's available in some hospitals in Metro Manila. So its use is not that widespread.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Joanna. The second question is, blood investigations for the recurrence NPC or skull-based osteoradionecrosis, despite the CT or MRI, are you agree with that, Prof. Ming Lim or Prof. Sheng Po or Afatar or Chok Chai? Blood investigations for the recurrence NPC or skull-based osteoradionecrosis.
Yeah, I think maybe I'll start first and maybe the other panelists could chip in. So I think the diagnosis should be made clinically rather than based on plasma EBV. So if the diagnosis is typical of ORN based on the clinical presentation, pain being a very prominent feature, plus the fact that the MRI shows bone marrow changes quite compatible with ORN changes, then I think you should consider that. But certainly I would routinely perform a biopsy whenever it's possible, at least in the nasopharyngeal areas, and just to document there's no residual cancer or recurrent cancers. And in that context, a plasma EBV may be helpful, meaning that if the plasma EBV is negative, then there's probably higher confidence that you're dealing with ORN rather than a recurrent cancers. But I think the take-home message is the clinical context rather than absolute based on the plasma EBV titers.
Okay. Yes. I agree with Chi-Ming what he has said. It is mainly is should be a clinical diagnosis rather than depending on plasma EBV DNA. Yeah, it should be a clinical and also with a bit of help from MRI radiologically.
I might add, the radiologist in me is speaking. CT scan will be very good in assessing bone. MRI is very good in assessing bone marrow. It would be really helpful if you can do both. It will give the clinician a wider perspective.
Yes, I agree that we don't use the plasma EBV DNA to detect the ORM, okay? We just depend on the clinical and the CT scan for that evidence.
Yeah. Thank you, Prof. Chok Chai. So I think we move to the questions of the indications after how long of concurrent chemoradiotherapy, if recurrent, we can give another radiations if patients not keen for surgery. Maybe this is for Professor Johanna.
Okay. After completion of concurrent chemoradiotherapy, I get imaging after 6 weeks. If the tumor has not gotten smaller, if it's the same size or it's gotten smaller, I don't touch it. I will observe and wait a few more weeks and repeat the imaging. If it has gotten bigger, then I will add immediately a small dose of radiation. I have added up to about 2,000 because my normal dose is about 7,000. I'll give another 2 weeks worth of radiotherapy. As long as I can do intensity module IMRT or IGRT so that it's very precisely targeted. Now, if the question is after a few months, how many months later or how many years later, I actually prefer to give radiotherapy after a year because after a year, I can give a significant dose, a dose that will actually help the tumor. Because if it's too soon after the radiotherapy, I can't give very much right away. So it may not be a clinically useful dose to give just a small dose. So it depends really on the modality that I can use, if it's a 3D, IMRT, IGRT, and how much time has elapsed. It's important.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Prof. Johanna. I would like to hear from other speakers and panelists. In your country, in your institutions, what is the time that to proceed to evaluations with the CT or the MRI or the PET scan after the CCRT? What is the best in your institutions? I would like to hear.
Well, yes. Okay, sorry. I'll start off first, Melinda. Where yes. I practice, the radiation oncologist will normally recommend 6 months after completing CCRT or an MRI.
6 months?
Okay. Yes.
Okay. In Malaysia, 6 months, yeah?
Yeah, in my sense, because they say it takes some time sometimes for the tumor to, or the nodes to respond to the radiation and the chemotherapy. So they advise 6 months. Six months.
Sorry.
Yes, Dr. Avatar, are you finished?
Yeah. At the same time, they also normally will suggest before the MRI to repeat a local biopsy from the nasopharynx, if possible.
So that is before the 6 months or after 6 months?
Before the 6 months.
Okay. So I would like to hear, Prof. Chok Chai, you would like to give a comment.
Yes, I mentioned before that when the patient have the local regional failure, which one you send to the radiologist for the radiation, it depends on the bar line between the tumor control probability and the normal tissue complication. Usually the timing is more than 6 months that we consider the re-irradiation again. So before 6 months, I think it's not, is the normal tissue complication is too high.
Okay, so Prof. Shengpo, you would like to add some informations?
Yeah, you know, I think in Taiwan, the situation is a little bit different because we have the EBV cell-free DNA load as a, you know, adjunct to our clinical diagnosis, which is, I think, very, very helpful to allow you to make your decision. I think usually because we closely monitor the NPC patient with EBV cell-free DNA, so if you have a persistent elevated EBV, you know, DNA load, and then for sure you will know the patient is going to have some recurrence or some residual cancer, so you're kind of waiting for that. And the period we would, you know, typically wait for 6 weeks after the completion of radiation therapy, and may take the biopsy if the EBV DNA load is still elevated. And then I think for the imaging study, we typically will wait for PET CT, usually around, the best time will be around 10 to 12 weeks after the completion of radiation therapy. But you could do as far as early as in, you know, 8 weeks after radiation therapy. That's allowed the tissue to heal a little bit after the radiation therapy. So that's the time for PET CT, or even for the MRI is still the same. And so I guess because of the EBV DNA load, that really helped us to make our own clinical judgment. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Prof. Shengpo. How about in Singapore, Prof. Ming Lim?
Yeah, Singapore, we do a MRI about 3 to 4 months after completion of treatment, and primarily to see whether there's complete resolution of the all disease that's evident. We do a PET scan about 10 to about 6 months to a year, but only in select cases because PET CT is not it may not be fully subsidized for some patients. So, but whenever possible, a PET scan is be offered about 6 months to a year.
Okay, thank you. It's more clear now of all, I think, for the, all the attendees. So, there is a good, I think there is a good questions. Indication CT, indication chemotherapy with concurrent chemo radiations has better overall survival than concurrent chemo radiations long in stage 4. How about this, Professor Johanna?
Okay, induction chemo is usually given for locally advanced nasopharyngeal CA. So they were giving the induction for metastatic disease. Is that the situation? Because if there is metastatic disease, I think there was another question about that.
Yes.
It's metastatic disease, yes, chemotherapy upfront will probably benefit the patient, and then followed closely after by concurrent chemo RT.
Yeah. So it means that the CT with induction chemo with concurrent chemo radiations is better survival than CCRT alone?
For metastatic disease and for locally advanced disease, yes.
Okay. Maybe other speaker would like to give more information, a different view? No? Okay. I think we have more questions now. This is a very practically, but it's important. There's a question about how to manage NPC with middle ear effusions. Anyone would like to answer? Going through with the meningotomy or put it the Shepard tube right away or just continue with the radiations or chemo radiations? How to manage NPC with the middle ear effusions? Prof. Chokchai, maybe.
Yes, I will put the ventilating on to ventilate because the middle ear, because the eustachian tube is not function properly at this time after the treatment.
Okay. Ming Lim would like to add?
Yeah, so usually persistent fluid after 6 months post-treatment, I will intervene. I'll give the patient, depending what the patient's symptoms are, if the patient main complaint is hearing loss, then I would ask him or her to consider hearing aid. I will selectively offer myringotomy and tube, but with the understanding that the patient may sometimes end up with a chronic serious otitis media and chronic discharging here. So something that they need to be mindful of. Yeah.
So you are not put the Shepard tube before the radiations?
No, I don't. I only do it only after 6 months post-treatment.
Okay. Thank you, Ming Lim. So any other speaker or panelists would like to add the information about this?
One more point is that after the...
Okay, Dr. Chai.
Yes, one more point is that after nasopharyngectomy, when you cut the eustachian tube, they may also may have some complication, OME complication as well. So you have to prepare to answer this question to the patient.
Yeah.
In my center, it's not a practice to put a myringotomy and Roman prior to the radiotherapy or after radiotherapy. If there is a persistent otitis media with effusion, we normally will offer a hearing aid to the patient.
Yeah.
Or fearing of complications of chronic otitis media later on, serious otitis media.
Okay. So there is a question, I think, for Professor Shengpo. How many centimeters tumor distance from the carotid artery is deemed?
Well, I think, if the tumor really about on the carotid artery, in our past experience, although we could do the surgery, however, the survival will be very poor. They were very easy to have a cavernous sinus recurrence after the nasopharyngectomy. So right now we would not do surgery on any cases with, tumor aborting on the carotid artery. And how many centimeter away from the carotid artery, I actually don't have any answer. But basically, if there is too much paranasopharyngeal space involvement, that is the pterygoid muscle involvement by the recurrent NPC, we probably would not do surgery. We'll probably send the patient for second course of chemo radiation therapy, because in my mind, there is really no surgical margin once the paranasopharyngeal soft tissue are involved. It's very difficult to get a real negative surgical margin in the muscle. I think you really need to, if you want to do the resection, you really need to remove the whole muscle. So, and that will be very, very difficult and carry much more complications. I don't know if Chuming has the same, what's your opinion about this, Chuming?
Yeah.
It's quite similar with you, Peter. So if paranasopharyngeal involvement is not an ideal candidate for nasopharyngectomy, even open approaches, I have done a one where I thought I could get a negative margin, but it was on the carotid sheath, which was positive on the frozen, but you cannot take the carotid. So we end up putting a flap and considering VRT in that context, but the patient eventually failed with recurrent and distant disease. So I think that's just anecdotal. So I probably will shy away from surgery in this context also.
Okay, that is also the question according this precious questions. What is the margin? How many centimeters is the margin for nasopharyngectomy? 1 centimeter, 2 centimeters? I think it's too big. Eh? Prof. Shengpo, you would like to answer?
Yeah, I pretty much rely on the intraoperative frozen section of my surgical margins. So we don't really count for how many centimeter of margin. We just send for a frozen section. But if I think we need to respect the natural barrier of the cancer, which is we need to know the how the tumor was spread. You know, the root of the tumor spread. Usually the tumor reside in lozenge fossa, and it will spread either most commonly through the so-called sinus morgani along the eustachian tube. So you just cut the eustachian tube, you know, as far later as possible as your later margin. And then the tumor might just go up to destruct the sphenoid sinus floor, bone of the sphenoid sinus floor. So you also need to remove that part of the bone. And of course, you could not send frozen section for bone margins intraoperatively. So I think, however, in my practice, I at least will burr out some of the sphenoid sinus floor and all the pterygoid plate base, a bone, to ensure there's you know, no tumor there, and try to you know, ease the tumor. And then you know, for the contralateral nasopharynx, I think there is also a question asked if there's, we could just remove one side of nasopharynx. But in my practice, I will always remove all the nasopharyngeal mucosa, even the contralateral lozenge fossa. But you know, I could preserve the contralateral eustachian tube. However, I will remove the contralateral nasopharynx, you know, lozenge fossa mucosa completely, because I think in nasopharynx, the width of the nasopharynx is actually not too wide, so it could, that will be very easy for you to remove all the mucosa.
Okay, thanks, Prof. Shengpo. Other would like to add the informations about this, according this. If it's not, I will proceed with other questions. There is a questions, Prof. Shengpo.
Yes.
May I know how good is the successful rate of gamma knife radiosurgery for recurrent NPC with skull-based invasions?
I think for T1 lesions, it has been very good. There are some reports. I think the gamma knife radiosurgery has been very good. I think Bintang reported as well. I think if you have a good selection of the case, you have a good MRI to make sure it's only mucosa recurrence only, and then recurrent T1, I think you could reach around 90% of the survival. Yeah, but I think, you know, we tend to, you know, have a surgical spacement. So we tend to do nasopharyngectomy rather than using a gamma knife. But if the patient is not feasible, not suitable for surgery, certainly gamma knife will be a very good option.
Okay, maybe Professor Johanna would like to add the informations.
No, actually, I agree with Professor Shengpo. The thing with gamma knife really is the selection. It's the size of the tumor. So mm-hmm. it's not for everybody, but if you fit into the criteria, yes, the results are very good.
Okay, thank you. So there is a question also. May I ask Prof. Lim or Prof. Johanna or Prof. Yeah, another speakers or panelists. How about combining diffuse weight MRI and EBV evaluation in evaluation subject with high risk of NPC? Is it benefit? And how about giving antiviral for EBV post definitive treatment of NPC? Will it improve the recurrence rate? Yes, who would like to answer these questions. The combining diffuse day DWI diffuse weight MRI and EBV evaluation. Prof. Joanna, you would like to answer?
I unfortunately have no answer for that. I have no experience with the EBV consistently. I can't answer that. Sorry.
Thank you, Prof. Joanna. Never. Prof. Ming Lim, maybe you always use evaluations, the MRI, by using the diffuse weight?
I think our MRI in our institution, I'm not sure whether they use DW, but usually it's a contrasted MRI to see for enhancement of any mucosal post-treatment. I'm not familiar with the DWI for this context. In terms of using plasma EBV, it is quite built into our MPC protocol at National Cancer Center, where the radiation oncologists routinely perform EBV plasma in the patient's follow-up. And we have picked up small recurrences, primarily because the plasma EBV converts to a positive titus after initially was negative post-treatment and eventually developed a positive EBV titus. And we have done PET scan and pick up small recurrences that was eventually proven to be a recurrent disease.
Okay, thank you. And there is a question that I would like to ask you, all of the five. What is the directions of the research for this NPC? Based on the three speakers, do we have do we have to evaluate the genetic susceptibility or CD3 or BMH1? What is the direction research that maybe because we already have an Asian webinar and then maybe we also can start with the multi-center or multi-country research about the NPC. What is your suggestion, the directions of research now? Maybe Ming Lim?
Yeah, so I have a bias because that's what I do for MPC research. So I'm not sure whether it's the future, but I do cancer immunotherapy for MPC because it has an EBV target that we can actually use cell therapy to treat these cancers. So I think the cell therapy using T cell has been shown by several groups treating refractory MPC, but success is about 20%. Immunotherapy using PD-1 antibody, the keynote trial shows about 22% responders. So I think immunotherapy is probably something to consider in the future, mainly in terms of combination. Of course, the other areas that could potentially help is beyond looking, doing optics evaluation. I think some groups have looked at near infrared to look at the other imaging technology beyond the standard white light imaging, such as the MBI as one. Certainly other techniques using optics technology could help. One group is using Raman spectroscopy to do surveillance. We began doing this as a research tool, but currently we don't really have any robust data to show that this outperforms standard clinical evaluation. I think there are also certain groups doing MPC brush, nasopharyngeal brush, in addition to routine surveillance. So I think this seems to be what I know that's happening in the space of MPC research.
Okay. Is anybody would like to give more information about this? Maybe already start research in this the country? Malaysia, Taiwan, or Philippines, or no? Okay.
In terms of radiotherapy, it really is just being able to deliver the biggest dose safely to the most precise area. So it really is that. But as I said earlier, without the precise imaging, the precise radiotherapy is useless.
Okay. Thank you so much, Prof. Joanna and Professor Ming Lim.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
May I, Professor Joanna, how about proton therapy?
proton therapy?
You know, proton therapy is an example of a potential very precise treatment, and it will actually shorten the treatment times because right now our treatments are 6-7 weeks long, but the technology is expensive. So unless we can get it out there to more people, then it probably won't be that used that much.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, before I close, because there's still questions, and then I think we cannot answer all the questions. I think Tote or the JJ will collect all the questions, and then we also can send the answer by sending the email. And then also there's a question, how the participant can get the certificate. The certificate, it will send via email. The certificates, e-certificate will send via email to the attendees. So I think I need just two minutes, how to manage the local regional recurrence based on the experience in your country. Maybe I will start with Professor Sheng Po Hao.
How to manage the
local regional recurrence?
How to manage the local regional recurrence? The simultaneous local regional recurrence.
Yes.
Surgery, of course.
Okay. How long that after the concurrent chemo radiation?
Six weeks.
Okay. So yeah. Usually,
it's better after 12 weeks.
After 12 weeks.
Better.
Or maybe you would like to go on with the chemotherapy instead the surgery?
No, we would not do chemotherapy before any surgery, before any chemotherapy before surgery. We prefer not to do that. And however, if you the patient is not good for surgery, then of course you might consider chemotherapy before definite radiation.
Thank you, Prof. Sheng Po. Go to the Professor Johanna.
Of course, I would answer re-irradiation. Okay. The dose would really depend on how long after, but yeah, I stick to my to my practice. Yes.
Okay. So different path. Eh? So okay. Ming Lim, what about you?
I'm a surgeon, so I have surgical bias. But joke aside, but I think there is a recent randomized phase 3 study conducted in Sun Yat-sen. I think just published, I think this week actually, in Lancet Oncology. So they randomized 100 patients with resectable recurrent disease to endoscopic nasopharyngectomy versus re-RT. I must say that the endoscopic nasopharyngectomy did better. But certainly there are good results with re-RT. It's just that based on that trial, in a very high volume center in Sun Yat-sen, they managed to pull off this phase 3 study results. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Ming Lim. So go to the Prof. Chok Chai. How about you in Thailand? Unmute, please. Prof. Chok Chai, your voice.
Okay, it depends on the tumor recurrence that is resectable or not resectable. In case that resectable, we try to resect it. But in some case that we cannot resect it at all, we send it to the radiologist. For the next recurrence, we try to do the neck dissection to remove the whole neck, the whole neck structure out. We not try to do the modified neck dissection, but we intend to do the radical neck dissection in those recurrent cases after the radiotherapy.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Chok Chai. Now, Dr. Afatar.
Yeah, the option will be, if it's operable, yes, surgery for the patient, endoscopic nasopharyngectomy, and for the neck, will be a radical neck dissection.
Okay, I think I already asked all the three speakers and two panelists. And then because of the time also, I think, I will say thank you very much for the very interactive, informative, very nice presentations from the three speakers, valuable speakers, and also from the comment from the two panelists. And then now it's time for us. Also, I would like to say thank you for the attendees, and then they are very active to give the questions. So it's time for us to start with the always since the first episode of Asians Head and Neck webinar, we always closed the sessions with the singing. Something that we love so much beside using our blade, the multinational and comprehensive singer. We are the world. The song that we choose tonight is full of meaning. It doesn't matter where you're from, the color of your skin, or any of the other things that stand in people's way. We are all humans, and there should never be a thought to helping others. Do what you can. You never know if it could or will be you. Let's sing. We are the world. Let's join our hands for a great chance and to widening knowledge and anything else that the society can help. Enjoy the song and our performance. Professor Christopher Goh to give a closing remarks.
Thank you, Professor.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Melinda. Well, come to the end of this extremely successful 7th ASEAN Head and Neck webinar. I would like to thank our panelists, my very good friends, Professor Chok Chai and Professor Avata. They have provided an excellent and succinct summary of the gist of today's webinar. I'd also like to thank our speakers, Professor Lin Chui Ming, Professor Johanna Kanal, and Professor Sheng Po Hao. Professor Hao is a close friend of mine, and I must say that he's still as witty and as charming as ever. And we will accept his Hong Pao graciously. Anyway, all three speakers have given an in-depth and comprehensive discussion of the topics, and I must congratulate them for their outstanding presentations. Special thanks to our sponsors, J&J, for their kind and generous support since the beginning of this webinar series. I've also an important announcement to make. Our next webinar will be on tumors of the nose and paranasal sinuses, and it will be held in April. So do look out for it and join us if you can. And bring your friends also. Finally, we have our photo taking session. So turn on your videos and give your best smile. Thank you, everyone.
Good night.
And good night.
Okay. Please turn on your camera. And say cheers. 1, 2, 3. Okay, just say she's around 5 to 10 seconds. I will capture okay. Your picture.
Okay.
Cheers.
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 Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, brother.
It's such a wonderful session and very interactive. Yes. Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Peter.
Thank you all.
And then Chok Chai.
Thank you, all speakers. Thank
yes,
you.
Yes, and Joey.
Patraful.
Lim.
Yeah, thank you, everyone. Avata.
Thank you all.
Brazil.
Thank you, thank you Peter.
Thank you for Ang Pao.
Ang Pao.
Yes, I'm waiting for that, Peter. I'm waiting. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Avatar.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes. All right.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Johanna, thank you, all participants. Yes.
Please, oh, thank you. Hello. For the good words.
Avatar, yeah.
thank you, Super Chris. One.
Yeah.
Super One.
Yeah, Super One. Here.
Edo.
Yeah,
bye-bye. Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Bye, Professor Alfredo.
Yes.
Ampao, Alfredo.
Daryl.